Hi all, and welcome to the first video for Lesson 3 of Ocean 215. Today, we're going to be talking about lists, object types, and logical operations. This lesson is going to be divided into four parts. Each part will have a separate video. The first video, the one you're watching right now, is what is a list. The next video will be list functions. The third video will be object types. And the final video will be logical operations. I encourage you guys to take breaks between these videos. It makes it a lot easier for you to retain the information, and it's nice if you're not sitting in front of a computer all the time. All right, jumping right in, what is a list? If you recall, when we were talking about strings in the last set of videos, we talked about how they have a length, and that length has to do with how many characters, including spaces, are in that string. So here we have this example string. This is an example string. And you'll notice that when we do the length function, we get that there are 25 characters, including spaces. Lists are very similar to strings in the way that they also have a length. They also have a number of objects in it. However, those objects aren't just characters, they can be anything. That includes numbers. So in this case, I've created an example list with just numbers. Here, I have my variable name, and I set it equal to this thing in the square brackets. That's how you denote a list. And I put some things inside of that square bracket, some numbers, and I separate those by commas. So here we have an integer, we have a couple of floats, we even have a negative number. All of those exist happily together in this list. A list can also have booleans. So if you recall booleans, they're the true false objects in Python. And we have this variable name set equal to this list that I've created with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different booleans. And of course, when we do the length function, that's exactly what we get. We get that there are 5 items in this list. A list can also have strings. So if you see again, there's a variable name and I set it equal to this stuff in a square bracket. And each of these words is an individual string. You can tell because of the beginning and the end quotes. And each of these strings is an object in this list. And that's, you can tell because of the commas separating each word. When we do a length on this list, we get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 items, right? Because there are 5 words. So lists can have numbers, booleans, strings. Lists can also have lists as objects. So here I've created a list of lists. Here we have the outer brackets, and inside we have our string list and a comma, our Boolean list and a comma, and then finally we have our number list. So inside of this list of lists, we have 3 different list objects. Now, that means that when we do the length function on this list of lists, we only get 3 items. No matter how many items are inside of the inner lists, the outer list just has to do with how many lists are in this list. You'll notice here that I wrote out each of these lists. Another way that we could have created this list of lists was by using the variable names we assigned to each one previously. So here we have the same variable name for this list of lists. And we say the list string example here, which we assigned to this. And then we put a comma and we put the list bool example created here, same variable name. And then we say the list num example, or the numbers created here, and then we put it here. So doing this is actually exactly the same as writing out each individual object. So a list doesn't just have to have all the same kind of object in it. You can change up the different kinds of objects and mix and match. So in this case, I've written sort of a list of book information about Don Quixote. So we have the title, Don Quixote, the author, Miguel de Cervantes, the years published, 1605 and 1615. Notice that it's got a list there, and that's because it was published in 2 different years as 2 parts. The number of pages, 863. And if it's available in the library, which is true. So we print that out and you can see we have our list and it has those square brackets around each of these objects. A list can also be empty. So it can have just empty brackets if you set a variable name to it. And if you try and do the length of that, you get 0 items, but you can print out just those empty brackets. Now let's talk a little bit about list indexing and slicing. If you recall string indexing and slicing, where we had this string Python is fun, and you have the index values 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, all the way up to the end of the string, Python indexes lists exactly the same way as strings, right? So here we again have our book info with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 items in it. But notice that we start our indexing at 0. So we have item 0, item 1, item 2, item 3, and an item 4. So if we want to select out just a single item of this list, we can. We can select it using the square brackets here after the variable name, which we've attributed to this list. So book info of 1 is Miguel de Cervantes, right? If you want to do a slice of a list, you do it the same way as we did with strings, where we start with the first index you want, and you go up to, using a colon, but not including the last index you want, right? So you have 0, 1, and up to, but not including 2. So we have Don Quixote and Miguel de Cervantes. So lists can be a little bit strange because the objects inside of it can also have a length, right? So for example, item number 1, Miguel de Cervantes, the author's name, is a string. So when we select that out, we actually get this full string, which then we can slice again. So if we do this as one function here, we have book info of 1, which is just saying book info, the author, and then we slice that 0 up to 6, right? So we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and up to 6. So we just get Miguel. So there's another way to index your lists, and that is sort of using negative indexing. So here we have negative indexing. The negative 1 is at the last position. Negative 2 is second to last. Negative 3 is third to last. Negative 4 is fourth to last, and so on and so forth, however long your string is. Now, if you write book info of negative 1, it's the exact same thing as writing book info of 4. And that is our Boolean true there. If you write book info of negative 3, and book info of 2, that's the exact same thing, and that gives us our list of publication dates. Using these negative indices is helpful, especially when you have very long lists, because you don't necessarily want to use the longest values and the largest index values. You want to be able to cut right to the end and go from there. Items in a list can be replaced using their index values. So we can select out an item in the list and say, I would like to change that. Here we have our book info, right? Don Quixote, Miguel de Cervantes, publication dates, page numbers, and if it's available in the library, and say that someone checks it out of the library. So we have to change this to false now. So what we can do is we select it out using our book info, negative 1. This is, again, the same thing as writing book info of 4, right? Because it's the same index here. And we say that it equals false. And when we print it out, you can see that it's now replaced that object with a false Boolean. If you're starting at the beginning or stopping at the end of a list when you're slicing, you can omit the index value in your slice. So we talked about this a little bit with strings, but we're going to go more in depth. When we say book info of nothing, colon, comma, 3, it's the same thing as writing 0, colon, 3, right? So that will give us 0, 1, 2, and up to, but not including 3. So it gives us the title, the author, and the publication years. Again, if you use book info 2, colon, nothing, that's the same thing as saying you want to go to the end of the string. So it'll say book info 2, colon, 5, right? It'll go one further than the very end of the list there. And that will give us our publication years, our page numbers, and our availability. You can also slice using a step argument to get every nth items in a list. And by nth, I mean every first item, every second item, every third item, every fourth item, and basically however many ways you want to slice it, right? So you do that by using, this is your start, this is your stop, and then you add an extra colon, and then you can give it a step value. So in this case, when we use a step value of 1, it's saying, let's have every value, right? So that gives us every value in that list. However, when I use a 2, right? So I have my start value, my stop value, and I use a 2 as my step value, it gives me every other item in the list. So Don Quixote skips the author, publication years, skips the page numbers, and then true. Similarly, if we use a 3 as our step, it gives us Don Quixote, skips the next 2, and gives us our page number. And finally, if we use a -1 instead, it will actually reverse our list. So instead of our title, author, years, published, pages, and availability, it will give us availability, pages, years published, author, and title. There are a couple other objects that I want to talk about and touch briefly that are very similar to lists. The first of which is tuples. A tuple is the same as a list, except they're immutable, which just means that we can't change the items inside once they're assigned. You create a tuple using parentheses instead of square brackets. So here we create the same list we had before, except now it's a tuple. And when we try to do that same function of replacing the true with the false, notice that it prints out this error where a tuple object does not support item assignment. And the final object I want to talk about today is a range. Now, a range object creates a sequence of numbers. The sequence starts from 0 and increases by ones by default, but that can be changed. And the object created is a range object, but specific numbers in the sequence can actually be called using the same indices as lists and strings. So to create this range object, you write range, parentheses, you can give it a start number, you have to give it a stop number, and then you can give it an optional step number as well. So here are a couple examples. Here I've created a range and it starts at 0, it goes up to 10, and it's stepping by 1. And that's because I didn't give it a start or a step, I just gave it the stop. So if I print out a few of those values, indexing as 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4, notice that it starts at 0 and goes up by 1. Now here I've created a range giving it a start and a stop value. And notice that when I do the same thing and I print out the 0 index, the 1 index, the 2 index, the 3 index, and the 4 index, it starts at 5. So 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9, rather than starting at 0. And that's because I gave it a start number. Finally, I've created a range object with a step value. So here I have a start of 5, an end of 50, and a step value of 5. So when I do the exact same indexing, so I have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, notice that it has 5, 10, 15, 20, and 25. So in this way, you can index these range functions to get the numbers in the sequence. That's all for this video. The next video, we're going to be talking about list functions. Again, I encourage you guys to take a break, and I will see you shortly.